Major funding for America's War on Poverty was provided by the Ford Foundation, the Charles Stewart Mott Foundation, the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, and by the annual financial support of viewers like you. In addition, America's War on Poverty was also supported by the generous donations of foundations and individuals. A complete list of funders is available from PBS.
You've got to have a lazy, no good people before you have welfare. No one has a right to sit and do nothing and get paid for it.
When you go before the welfare department, you're pegged as a beggar. You're going out there to beg, and when you do that, it's because you really need it.
The war on poverty was supposed to make welfare obsolete. Instead, the welfare rolls were growing, and welfare recipients, rather than costing America less, were demanding more.
Why do they look down on us? Why do they say all welfare mothers are bad?
In 1968, the presidential candidates and thousands of welfare mothers challenged America to redefine the rights of the poor.
I know what poverty means to people.
We are going to build a great society.
Every man and woman has a chance for fulfillment and prosperity and hope. This can be done.
We are dealing with issues that cannot be solved without the nation spending billions of dollars and undergoing a radical redistribution of economic power.
Yes.
Therefore, we must see that it is much easier to integrate a lunch counter than it is to eradicate slums.
Yes, sir.
It is easier to guarantee the right to vote than it is to guarantee an annual income or to create jobs. We've got to see that this is a different era.
4 years into the war on poverty, Americans feared the poor were becoming too dependent on government. More and more, the debate focused on the country's 30-year-old welfare system.
The welfare system is a result, not a causality. It's the end of failure. It exists because we have failed in other areas. And if we really want to solve the problem, we better do something about seeing that the other failures in our society are corrected. That's how we responsibly and humanely can deal with the problem of poor people.
People just hated welfare. Everybody, the women, the country, everybody hated it. It was very negative. And people also hated anybody that would raise hell about it.
Although it has been written into our laws that everyone has a right to assistance, I don't think basically a large majority of our population really believe this.
On the last day of March 1968, Lyndon Johnson, the president who had first declared war on poverty, stunned the nation.
I shall not see, and I will not accept the nomination of my party for another term as your president.
The future of federal poverty programs was now in question. Within days, Martin Luther King was assassinated. Months later, Robert Kennedy was assassinated. America's poor were losing their champions.
Well, most of the time, I have the feeling that I'm mostly a third-class citizen. That's the way I get the feeling that I'm being treated.
I think there's something wrong in society that we don't give people the opportunity to not be on welfare from the beginning of their life, from when they're born. Nobody should be poor.
$25 million people lived below the poverty line of $3,500 per year for a family of four. Most poor people had not asked for government aid, but as the idea of a right to welfare took hold, many more applied.
Welfare really is for many women at the lower rungs of our economic system. It is a safety net in which they move into the welfare system when a crisis hits their families.
I wasn't born on welfare. I worked in the fields and I worked in the laundry for 23 years. That's why I got sick.
I remember going into the welfare office asking for support and they refused to help me. And the reason they gave me was because I was married and they contacted my husband. My husband said, send her back home. We'll work it out. And they never took in consideration that there was violence involved.
A caseworker could make it, very, very unhappy for people and totally remove their dignity. And it was not a good system because it depended on not on the right of the person, but on how it was interpreted by a caseworker.
They say this is a big, rich town, but I live in the poorest part.
Federal and state governments funded welfare, but rules differed from state to state. Most states required caseworkers to search for signs of unreported income.
Some of them, not all of them, but some of them would actually look in your closets and just take total liberty with your person, with the place that you were living. And I think the worst thing was they questioned your children.
And I remember my mother telling me, no mencione a papi. You know, don't mention that your father came, don't mention him. And I'm wondering, you know, I love my father, you know. I thought I was daddy's little girl, and she's telling me not to mention him. So I was kind of hard not to acknowledge his presence. You know, it's like he didn't exist.
Families on welfare struggled with bureaucracies over which they had little control.
All of the kids were going to the science museum. And my son came home with a piece of paper, and I think they had to pay $3 or something like that. And so I called the school and I said, look, I really don't have $3 for tomorrow morning. Is it possible that I could pay the money, you know, when I get my check? I mean, everything is based around your check. So she said, no, I'm sorry. Your child won't be able to go.
They used to have the GO Club where you would, you know, go to the auditorium and see this educational film. I used to look forward to that. I found it so stimulating. But that was assembly and we all had to wear white shirts, white blouses. And I remember, I guess I had outgrown mine because I was heavy or I was going through puberty. I had outgrown mine. So as usual, I went to the auditorium with the class and I'm sitting down and I'm waiting to see. And the teacher pokes me on my shoulder and says, come on. And that was the last time I ever saw a GO film. And it was never explained to me why I was pulled out. And then I remember as a child thinking, how can I explain to the teacher that my mother can't afford to buy me a blouse?
They can't say I'm a wasteful mother because I'm not. I'm not. In every angle that I see that I can make this money stretch, that's what Janie do. That's exactly what I do.
We wanted to bring about dignity to ourselves because we knew we were somebody. We were mothers. We loved our children just like a working person loved their kids. And we wanted to be respected that way. And we began to organize. Then that's how I became active, being a welfare mother, being mistreated.
Mothers, frustrated by the welfare system, had been organizing local welfare rights groups. By 1968, 300 of these groups were united within the National Welfare Rights Organization, NWRO.
And now we're banding together to really get something going. We have locals already set up.
War and poverty, you know, had this thing called the maximum feasible participation of the poor, and in some ways the welfare rights movement got to the heart of that. I mean, here was a movement that attempted to maximize the participation of the poor.
Beulah Sanders led NWRO in New York City. New York alone had 40% of the national membership.
Welfare is not geared to help you get on your feet at all.
I don't care how much you try and you strive to make it on your own. Now, for I could give you other cases where people have tried to better themselves and they have gotten no help from welfare.
We were representative of many, many women on public assistance around the world, actually, because the poverty is women and kids.
From headquarters in Washington, D.C., George Wiley directed the NWRO. A former chemistry professor, Wiley believed what many did not, that poor people could organize to change the system that governed their lives.
Welfare recipients want money. They want a share in this very rich country that they have. They want to be treated with dignity and respect. We also want jobs for people that can work. We want adequate training programs. We want daycare centers. We want good schools. We want a lot of other things. But the most basic thing poor people need is money.
What they were about is building an all people's movement, a poor people's movement, which to them meant everybody that was in fact poor, white, black, Mexican, Latinos. The job was to try to build a movement of poor people to demand their rights.
Dr. Wiley's slogan was, our slogan was, adequate training, adequate jobs, adequate pay. And I didn't see nothing wrong with that. And our other slogan was, welfare is a right and not a privilege.
The welfare system, originally called Aid to Dependent Children, had been signed into law by President Franklin Roosevelt as part of the 1935 Social Security Act.
This Social Security measure gives at least some protection to 30 millions of our citizens who will reap direct benefits through unemployment compensation, through old age pensions, and through increased services for the protection of children and the prevention of ill health.
Welfare was designed as a small program for widows with children. But since 1935, the rolls had increased steadily, and in 1968 alone, they jumped by 20%. In this presidential election year, many feared welfare was becoming a way of life for generations.
What we need, rather than more millions on welfare rolls or more millions on payrolls.
We go out and work for what we want, and we barely make it.
I know people work for $50 a week, and I know people on welfare to get more than that, $250 a month.
For a very long time, the welfare rolls has consistently stayed mostly 80% white, literally, for white people. And so here are all these blacks and Hispanics and other groups now coming onto the welfare system and even demanding even more. I mean, the idea was to come on welfare, but to be real quiet, to be ashamed, to be hiding, and nobody knew you were even around.
Members of NWRO challenged the notion that poor people should be ashamed of receiving welfare. Their strategy was to recruit all eligible poor people and teach them how to apply for basic assistance and for one-time special grants for furniture and clothing.
I have five kids, and my husband works. He makes not much money. He only makes a few dollars which he brings home. Mm-hmm. And we're short of money to buy all the things we need.
Our main job in welfare rights is teaching people on welfare that they have rights and what those rights are, and then encouraging them to exercise them.
Here were people who had a direct economic tie to the government, and if they organized in relationship to that direct economic tie that they had, they would basically be organizing their participation in government. The weakness of the American system is that people do not participate in their government.
NWRO activists wanted fundamental reform of the welfare system.
Don't tell you about this paper. What's in this paper?
Their goal was a guaranteed adequate income for all Americans. To help pressure lawmakers, They created a coalition of supporters.
And one of the things that George was very good at, along with Beulah and Johnny, was to utilize a lot of programs that had staff people, VISTA programs, so forth. And they basically took up welfare rights organizing.
We were friends of welfare rights, and we were connected to the national movement. We paid dues. We had a pin called Friends of Welfare Rights, and we got their newsletter, and so we were linked to the movement.
Poor people in the cities are becoming a political force. Black people are becoming a political force. Puerto Ricans are becoming a political force. And governmental agencies, whether it's the school system or the welfare department or the housing authorities or whatever, are becoming more responsive to them.
In New York, NWRO appeared to be moving toward its goal of a guaranteed income. State officials discussed replacing special grants for furniture and clothing with an annual flat grant.
In an ordinary life situation, you receive a salary and you live on it. Or you have an income and you live on it, whatever it may be. And that was much fairer. Rather than somebody having to go and say, I need a winter coat, I need this, I need that, and be a supplicant.
As more recipients demanded more benefits, welfare caseworkers in New York City began voicing their concerns. Welfare Commissioner Jack Goldberg needed answers.
As far as the city is concerned, we're very eager to have anybody review the whole problem of the increase in caseload and the increase in welfare costs, because it is a serious problem.
Some of the people were very angry about it. Some people were feeling that, just as other taxpayers were feeling, that poor people were getting things that they didn't have.
Overworked and fed up with NWRO activity, some caseworkers sat in at the office of the welfare commissioner.
There are huge mobs outside the center. The clients cannot get in to be serviced, and the front doors to the center have been broken in by clients. Several of our workers have been jostled leaving and entering the office.
People I work with and others said it's just a matter of time before the state legislature would react. And sure enough, late in 1968, special grants were eliminated and replaced with flat grants.
The flat grant was hundreds of dollars less than NWRO had expected. Members felt they had to take action.
The demonstrations were planned for several days in August, out in front of City Hall, and it was a confrontation.
It was important that we make a statement regarding parenting, that parenting is an important job in this country, and we wanted to make certain that our kids grew up to be adults who were self-supporting and who would give back to the community.
I want a better education for my child. I want my 18-year-old son to finish school, not drop out because I don't have enough money to buy him a pair of shoes. They are not even giving us enough to even halfway live. So therefore, they should not say that if we go out and try to work and try to take care of our children, that they would deduct from our check.
Recipients who worked had two-thirds of what they earned deducted from their basic welfare grant. Now, their clothing and furniture money was also drastically reduced.
Basically, what the Commissioner's also said is that he's now given every welfare recipient $100 a year to take care of all their clothing and housing needs. What we have been averaging is between $200 or $300 or $400 per person, because we have gone out and informed people of their rights. Once we started doing that, the city of New York has reacted by cutting back on what people are entitled to. And then to call that an improvement in the system, I think doesn't make any kind of logical sense.
When news came that Mayor Lindsay was unavailable, the women tried to push past the barricades and into City Hall.
the memory of these horses. Oh, the horses now were coming into to the folks. And they were talking essentially primarily women, some of them with their children. And it was a very scary situation.
We worked so hard to get people involved and to help them take control of their lives. And our main drawing card was that we would get them the items that they were entitled to. Well, they took that away from us.
Without the special grant, NWRO began to lose members. Other states also reduced grants. NWRO was in serious trouble. So were America's cities. Local officials looked to the federal government for help.
This city cannot continue to pick up the tab for what is out there with regard to welfare costs, and then collectively, nationally, we better come up with some better answers than the answers that we have so far.
And one of the ways to even this off is to make the system of welfare uniform. And the only way to do that is to federalize it.
From the beginning of the war on poverty, Lyndon Johnson had rejected the idea of a federally guaranteed income for Americans. It was a revolutionary idea, giving all poor people enough money to bring their incomes up to the poverty line.
I just don't believe that a handout is superior to working at a job commensurate with your skills, even if that job is dead end or menial.
The issue is not finding more jobs or recruiting welfare recipients to get off welfare. The issue is more money. How can you possibly tell a client that they must get a job and get off welfare when they have to receive enough money to maintain their families, and the minimum wage is still at $1.60 an hour?
The perception of America was different, that we were beginning to create a class of people who were living on the dole. And because they lived on the dole, people thought relatively well, not the people on it, but others, that therefore one had to do something to reform it.
Mother, mother, there's too many of you crying.
Overshadowing the debate on poverty was the war in Vietnam.
There's far too many of you die.
The American people were divided over the war and over civil unrest at home. There were riots in the cities, student protests, increasing calls for law and order. On November 6, 1968, the Republican candidate Richard Nixon was elected president.
We are making a charge to the new incoming Nixon administration today that this Nixon administration, which has talked about law and order all through its campaign, that it begins to uphold law and order in its food program.
Wiley now pushed to make the National Welfare Rights Organization a force in national politics.
In the past, we had not spent very much time in the whole national lobbying effort. We did more in terms of putting pressure on the system.
Wiley, I think, thought that you could do both, that you could do a certain amount of protesting, direct action, disrupting, and at the same time, you could do the conventional lobbying. And he tried to do both.
In the earliest days of the new administration, Nixon requested that his counselor for urban affairs, Daniel Patrick Moynihan, a Democrat, look into welfare reform. Moynihan sought input from George Wiley. Wiley, in turn, hoped Moynihan would put him in touch with Robert Finch, the secretary of HEW.
That was the major thing that he wanted from Moynihan at that time, and we wanted Finch to do some things on policy, and Moynihan did come through and get us hooked up to Finch.
This is a very definite constituency, and they have some very able people involved, particularly in their staff, and we want to discuss as we get into these regulations, get their input.
Yes, I should say that, again, that we did have a successful meeting. We think it was very successful, and we are looking forward to continuing such things.
Mr. Moynihan met with us. Mr. Finch now has met with us. They have indicated an openness. If they follow through, and if they continue to be open and allow for participation, if they do enforce their laws and regulations, and if they do start moving toward adequate income, which is our most basic issue, is enough money for everybody.
Let us share our resources. Let us share them.
Nixon's domestic agenda began to take shape. His proposal, called the New Federalism, was designed to reorganize and decentralize government. The welfare system was one target of the plan.
One of the problems which the first the Johnson administration, later the Nixon administration, tried to tackle was the problem of what was then considered ballooning welfare costs.
The rolls were increasing dramatically and quickly, and it concerned a lot of people. People on the left, people on the right, people in the middle, just, and it was a puzzle. Why was this happening? What was going on?
The thing that is so interesting to the president is, how do you make American work? How do you make government succeed at what everybody says it ought to succeed at? So how do you make city government function? How do you get a welfare system that helps people and heals them and that doesn't destroy them?
He did not like welfare workers. In fact, if there had been some way to just banish all the welfare workers, he would have been very pleased with that.
There really was in Nixon a little bit of the kind of British Disraeli idea that to get liberal things done, it takes a conservative to do them. I really think he would like to have had written in his history that what the Democrats couldn't do, solve welfare problems, feed hungry Americans, I could do. He would like to have had that in his record.
The administration was divided. Moynihan wanted to replace the current welfare system with a guaranteed income. Others wanted to modify the existing system. For 2 days, the president and his cabinet met at Camp David to discuss the options. Moynihan's plan won Nixon support.
The hard work had been done. Moynihan had a pretty clear idea of what he wanted in the family assistance plan, and the president's ideas were pretty basic, that people had to work, that this had to be a program that would get people off welfare and onto payrolls.
At the same time, NWRO was putting together its own version of a guaranteed income.
George, together with some people who helped him on it, various policy people that he talked to about it, George had the idea that there should be this idea of what would be an adequate income.
And what they did is, in fact, draw up their own budget and decided to, in fact, as a long, as the long struggle, defining the long struggle as for guaranteed adequate income. And their first call or rallying call was at $5,500 fight.
These people who believe in this think that everybody, by virtue of being born, existing on this earth, has a right to a decent level of income. Now, there are some problems. It runs up against reality, and you can't do it.
No welfare system is allowed to give welfare clients the same amount as a working person gets. Absolute. God knows what's going to happen to the country if this should ever happen. People would stop working. There would be a revolution. Everybody would want to be on welfare.
In August 1969, President Nixon announced his anti-poverty plan.
Whether measured by the anguish of the poor themselves or by the drastically mounting burden on the taxpayer, the present welfare system has to be judged a colossal failure. The new family assistance system I propose in its place rests essentially on these three principles. Equality of treatment across the nation, a work requirement, and a work incentive. Its benefits would go to the working poor as well as the non-working. For a family of four now on welfare with no outside income, the basic federal payment would be $1,600 a year. States could add to that amount, and most states would add to it.
The words working poor were very much a part of our vocabulary at that time, and this thing was focused on people who worked, wanted to work, wanted to have a job, had an expectation of doing well, but they couldn't make enough money.
It did seem to, I think the word is discombobulate the Democrats. And when this was not in their vision of what this guy Nixon was supposed to be. And the idea that Nixon could do something which he thought was right and at the same time upset the Democrats pleased him mightily.
The Family Assistance Plan was the first guaranteed income proposal ever backed by an American president, but it was far from NWRO's goal of $5,500.
We say that the Nixon proposals, by government's own figures, only represent the $1,600 minimum guarantee is only about the amount that the Department of Agriculture says is the amount necessary for food.
Our people ain't gonna starve, and we ain't about to see them starve. We're gonna get food and clothing and shelter one way or the other.
After Nixon's speech, the White House reported strong and positive public response.
You have to be a little cautious about public reaction because we generated an awful lot of public reaction to announcements. We had quite an apparatus that made sure that telegrams poured in and phone calls poured in and that kind of thing. So it was dangerous to believe your own press clippings.
Overhaul of the welfare system was only part of Richard Nixon's domestic plan. His proposal to reorganize the government included the dismantling of Lyndon Johnson's War on Poverty bureaucracy.
There's a recognition that the office needs complete restructuring, and my guess is that there will be support. If you ask the Office of Economic Opportunity to do everything in the world, it can't. And it has a charter so broad that it's been easy to criticize it and say it hasn't done well here and it hasn't done well there. And it's true it hasn't in some instances.
We did want to dismantle OEO, but we knew that the Congress wouldn't do it because the OEO pumped a lot of money into congressional districts. It had a very strong lobby. It had a strong constituency. So instead of just declaring one day that OEO was out of business, we resorted to all kinds of trick and artifice to try and strangle it.
Lyndon Johnson watched from the sidelines. It seemed all he had built was being torn down.
He had once said that he thought in the Great Society that he was creating this beautiful woman, and each law that he put on the books, the poverty programs, the civil rights program, the education programs, were making her more voluptuous. He had somehow this Rubenesque sense of what beauty was. And then later, watching President Nixon as president, he saw all these programs being cut back and undone and appropriations being taken away. And he said she was getting thinner and thinner and uglier and more wrinkled. And eventually they were going to put her in the closet to die, the Great Society, because they couldn't look at her anymore.
As Nixon cut back OEO programs and moved them to different departments, debate over his family assistance plan heated up. Welfare rights activists called a press conference to make clear their opposition to work requirements and to the proposed level of income.
Most of us feel that the question of the inadequacy comes out wherein $1,600 is not enough money for people to live on.
Now, we may have been cutting off our noses by our face, but that's not the way we felt about it. So we felt like $1,600 was not enough. It was not a good foot in the door. So we fought it.
Many of NWRO's middle-class supporters thought the family assistance plan was a step in the right direction and pressured the organization to go along with the Nixon proposal.
And they said, look where Social Security started. It started very small, and look where it's grown now. Take what you can get and accept that you're not going to get $5,500. Take the $1,600.
You're only hurting your cause this way. That's what all of us liberals say. Nobody likes things the way they are. But you go too fast and you go too far.
In 1969, more than 7 million people received welfare. 31% of the children had been born to unwed parents. Undermining support for welfare rights were fears that the system was creating a separate class of dependent people.
The question that welfare forces dependency is one that I don't understand. Poor people are dependent. They've always been dependent. Which came first? The horse or the carriage? For example, before the Great Depression, friends, relatives, private charities, voluntary agencies provided assistance to who? Dependent people.
Welfare mothers that are having illegitimate children will have to be curtailed. We have to make laws where they, after so many children, they don't receive welfare, that perhaps where the children are involved, they should be taken away from their mothers and put into institutions or homes where they can receive proper care.
These mothers that have a baby every year for a different man, if they were given a job and put out to work 8 hours a day, and then see that they go home and take care of the kids, they wouldn't have so many for the state to take care of.
Welfare was 2% of the national budget in 1969. NWRO faced strong opposition from Americans who wanted costs cut and recipients put to work.
I tried very hard to find a job. I just couldn't afford daycare. There was no way I could. I didn't even know who to ask to mind my children. Everybody I knew had lots of other kids too, and what was the use of me going to work? I thought, if I'm going to have to pay half my paycheck out.
I don't want welfare to support me. I want welfare to find a job for me, a job where I can work and make a living on my own. I don't want a charity.
There weren't jobs, and so the fundamental demand had to be for adequate income. We were not opposed, and neither were welfare recipients. They were open on the issue of work, if the income would be adequate.
But America was slipping into a recession. Unemployment was on the rise, and unskilled workers were the hardest hit.
People are unemployed today, not because they are lazy. People are unemployed not because they don't want to work. Fact is, some of you gathered here have worked the hardest and the longest on the nastiest job. And the technology that we work to produce has rendered us economically useless.
As demonstrations against the Vietnam War increased, NWRO also stepped up its anti-war activity, further antagonizing many Americans.
NWRO became more and more politically oriented. And we knew that the war was going on too long. Many of us, many of our members had kids in the service. We knew people's kids were getting killed. And also we knew that the money going into the war was being removed from the cities.
Conservative Democrats and Republicans were working to keep the cost of the proposed family assistance plan low. NWRO believed Americans did not understand what was at stake.
How do you dramatize that $1,600 a year was not enough for a family of four? And so that the idea was to try to get people to live on what $1,600 would buy.
Let's take a middle-class woman whose husband had died and suddenly there's no money. Taking her to the market and trying to teach her how to shop. There are no such things as lamb chops or steak or even, once in a while hamburger mixed with a whole bunch of other stuff to make it palatable, to spread it out. But it's an entirely different world for poor people.
NWRO supporters around the country, including the families of some U.S. senators, agreed to live for 1 week on the 23 cents per meal allowed under the family assistance plan.
I think that you almost would have to be a home ec major
in order to be able to figure out enough vitamin C in a welfare budget.
But the thing that was that really hit home to me was the lack of nutritional food. The brain food. How do you send your children to school with empty stomachs every morning? How can they learn anything?
My children to this day still remember it. I said, how did you feel? And they said, hungry. And that's the one thing that I remember about it. I remember the time it took me to figure out how to stretch the money was incredible. And the feeling of absolute hunger to the point of even feeling weak.
Whoa, oh, mercy, mercy me. Oh.
NWRO's campaign did not influence enough lawmakers. The proposed $1,600 grant and a strict work requirement passed the House. Now NWRO had to stop it in the Senate.
I'm for the idea that President Nixon spoke to when he said that we should have more workfare and less welfare. I believe that the majority of the committee would like to draft that kind of a bill.
On the Republican side of that committee, we ran into sort of ideological problems. Family assistance plan wasn't tough enough. It didn't force people back to work immediately, didn't get those welfare mothers off the rolls fast enough.
The passage in the House increased that tension, I mean, to people who are saying now you gotta do something now to defeat it in the Senate.
Now the president's saying he knows that if this bill is reported to the floor of the Senate, it will be overwhelmingly enacted as it was in the House. He asks that the Senate be allowed to vote.
The family assistance plan would give benefits to both the working and the non-working poor. The Senate Finance Committee opposed making millions more Americans eligible for federal aid.
We have a strange notion in this country that the only people who get federal help are welfare clients. The truth of the thing is that practically everybody in this country benefits from some type of federal benefit. Except when it goes to the rich, it's called subsidy.
Publicly, Nixon backed the plan, but privately, he began to pull away. Foreign affairs were his chief concern.
The president, at various times in the process of negotiating with the Senate Finance Committee, decided it wasn't worth the battle. He needed votes in the Senate on a lot of other things, foreign policy things, defense things. Sometimes he would say to me, look, just drop it. Forget it. Don't press it. We haven't got the money for it anyway.
Welfare rights activists were still pushing for a guaranteed income of $5,500. To make NWRO's case, George Wiley staged an event for the television cameras.
He thought that he needed to draw attention to what he thought was wrong with the family assistance plan, and the way to call attention was to go to the office of the Secretary of Health, Education, and Welfare, Mr. Robert Finch. And he took some reporters along with him.
Down in the street were other demonstrators of the NWRO, the National Welfare Rights Organization. At one point I recall seeing from the street, they were waving to the leaders who were waving from the window of Finch's office. Really, they said they had liberated it, not occupied it.
Hello! Hello! Liberated Secretary Finch's office! We will be running the policies of HEW from now on!
They didn't try to focus on me physically. They just said they were going to take over the department because they had to get this message out, and this was the only way they felt they could make their message.
We demand that this country begin supporting life and not perpetrating death on poor people in Vietnam, perpetrating death on black people in Georgia, at Orange Regard, South Carolina. Stop perpetrating death against students and stop the oppression of starvation and hunger of poor people here in this country and abroad.
And I remember when I got out of the cab, Roxanne was calling, come on out, Finch. She was calling for Finch to come outside, but she never came.
We are caseworkers without degrees. But that's a lie that we got after 2 years of college. Or we don't need no college education. We know the welfare laws better than you, Finchy.
We knew that there were demonstrations, but we also knew that they had been whipped up. I mean, these were very carefully orchestrated by the Welfare Rights Organization, which by then had no credibility with us at all.
By that time, they'd taken over and had people in the halls and so on. And so we got the Capitol Police in and we worked out an arrangement where they would have to go in and be booked.
NWRO's protest tactics were now unacceptable to many Americans.
A picture appeared in the Washington Post and in other papers which showed Wiley sitting at Secretary Finch's desk with his feet propped up on Finch's desk. The next day, and for weeks afterwards, I would hear from liberal Washingtonians what an awful thing it was, how arrogant it was that this guy would sit down and put his feet up on Finch's desk. And it killed a lot of George Wiley's middle class support.
With time running out, NWRO members asked to testify before the Senate Finance Committee. They were denied an audience. Senator Eugene McCarthy agreed to hold an unofficial hearing.
I, with the cooperation of a number of other senators, have arranged to hold the somewhat special hearing so that at this very late stage in this session, the position of the people most affected by this legislation could be presented for, we'd hope, the consideration of Congress, but certainly so that the public might know what is involved.
Welfare recipients and poor people across the country have been organizing over the last 3 or 4 years to get a voice in the making the policies and the laws that so vitally affect them.
And I'm sick and tired of the administration talking about forcing people to work. Now, where are they going to put us? In those lousy, menial jobs that's going to pay us $60 a week. I think I'm much more worth that. And I feel that if you're going to force me to work, you better give me something more than I'm getting from welfare. I ain't taking it.
You seem to think, then, that the entire vehicle would be better abandoned and start over with new legislation. Is that correct?
And at this present time, this bill is not good. So will you help us kill the bill?
Let me just say this to you, Mrs. Moore.
On December 19, 1970, the Family Assistance Plan died in the Senate.
I think we celebrated. I think we felt very good about that. We may not have had nothing to do with it, but we felt we did anyway. So it was a good feeling, and we thought we had a victory.
The women in the welfare rights movement started a debate that is yet to be resolved over workfare, childcare, and adequate incomes for all Americans. But what is not debated is the change the movement made in their own lives.
And watching the courage of these women, and watching them trying to raise their children, and watching their whole life being changed by putting on a button that said, I'm now welfare rights.
We made a statement in saying that we're going to fight for what we believe is rightfully ours, and we did just that.
I think it's so important that we remember, you know, the good sides, the struggle, the extraordinary leadership that was exercised under leaders like Martin King and Bobby Kennedy, but with those ordinary women all over America, those ordinary poor people all over America who had faith and who struggled to make American institutions respond in a non-violent way.
The soaring cost of welfare caused many states to continue cutting back benefits. And for 2 more years, NWRO kept up its fight for the poor people it represented.
I was come from a working family. I come from a religious home. I love my brother and sister. I realize I'm their keeper.
The greatest lesson in life for me was being poor. I have learned so much from it, and it has made me very compassionate, and maybe understand what it's like not to have enough money to feed your kids or to clothe them or to pay your rent. It's just so degrading.
Organizing in the welfare rights movement clearly had an effect on my life. It changed me. In one of the slogans that I developed, I said I was never prepared to live in a country that talked about a permanent underclass.
The 1960s had been a time when prosperity led Americans to believe that the nation could end poverty and eliminate welfare. These goals were not reached. But aided by economic growth and federal programs, by 1973, the percentage of Americans living in poverty was the lowest ever recorded.
I am personally convinced that in the long run, history will judge and should judge that the years of the war on poverty constitute one of the noble chapters in American history. Noble because the country as a whole, starting with its president, was saying, we will not tolerate a situation where the many who are okay say it's not their business to be concerned about those who are not.
The war on poverty just had a little series of services that it performed. And if you were lucky enough to be in the line to get one of those services, then fine, you might improve your life.
The federal government had made a lot of promises that it did not keep. And I thought it was cruel to do that to people who had lived without hope.
Stayed the course, continued to support these activities, and maybe done it smarter, that we would see today some greater and more lasting change than we did.
We have a better knowledge base to work from now. We have a body of experience that instructs us as to what works and what doesn't work.
Although the original War on Poverty bureaucracy is gone, all but one of its programs exists today. Some now funded by the private sector, others still funded by government, all with the goal of creating economic opportunity for America's poor.
We have to recognize as a society that there are no quick fixes to deep-seated problems, that they require sustained, active, committed work over long periods of time. And only with that kind of sustained work will we realize justice in this society.
Now we're talking about this, you know, the self-esteem, the welfare reforms, and all these other kinds of things. But see, we started all of these pieces trying to put them together 30 years ago, and we continue.
In order to wage an effective war on poverty today, it's going to take sustained leadership and commitment at all levels.
I don't think the government should do it all. The government maybe should facilitate in certain areas where the government intervention is necessary. But there's a responsibility on all of us to serve. And the people who need the service the most are the poor.
This series was produced by Blackside Incorporated, which is solely responsible for its content. Major funding for America's War on Poverty was provided by the Ford Foundation, the Charles Stewart Mott Foundation, the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, and by the annual financial support of viewers like you. In addition, America's War on Poverty was also supported by the generous donations of foundations and individuals. A complete list of funders is available from PBS. Video cassettes of this program for educational or institutional use may be purchased by writing or calling PBS Video. This program is not available for home video sales through this offer.
This is PBS.